right. So, Mark, thank you so much for joining us. This is our official kickoff of our seventh season, and we are excited to start it with completing our Beethoven Sonata cycle, which we started back in 2019. This journey is coming to an end, and Coldwell artists, three phenomenal artists are joining us. Rodolfo Leone, Dominic Celli, and Paul Williamson will join us, and we will finish up the last set of sonatas. So before we have the concerts next week, starting on October 25th, Mark, we really would love to have some input on what to expect, you know, what we are about to hear, and if you can lead us into this journey and prepare us for that. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you so much, Milana, and thank you everyone who is joining us in this moment now and who tunes in later and sees us on YouTube. It's been an incredible journey for me too. You know, this is an opportunity that really doesn't present itself very often, even when you're a full-time musician or music producer. This opportunity to really traverse a body of work like this is just a really special treat. And it's hard to believe that, you know, here we are now finally at the summit, where we're going to talk today about the last 10 of Beethoven's piano sonatas. You know, in a way, it almost feels like we're not, you know, if we think of Beethoven's life as being a trilogy with this early, middle, and late period, and we compare that to other trilogies, it's not really like we're just jumping into the third book. This is more like jumping into the second half of the second book, because here we really see this evolution of Beethoven from his high middle period to, you know, the mature works, you know, the fully mature works of his last years on the planet. So, of course, you know, a lot of this repertoire that's being presented, you know, represents things that I could talk about for an hour all by itself. I could easily talk about the last three sonatas for an hour. I have attended lecture recitals on the Hammerklavier sonata that have, you know, gone for two or 3 hours. So, you know, the idea here will be not so much to maybe get into the nuts and bolts of things that maybe, you know, only a pianist would understand, you know, but the idea here is to continue putting Beethoven and these works into historical context. Because I think by understanding who he was, where he was, the situations around him, then that gives us an opportunity to, you know, really experience this music with a sense of enlightenment. So hopefully we paint a biographical portrait. We do have some musical excerpts queued up, and you know, let's get right to it. So starting with the Sonata number 22. The Opus 54. Here we are. The year is 1804. I feel like for the last couple of lectures, we've kind of been right here between 1801 and 1805. And it was an extremely, there's good reason for that. It was an extremely productive period in Beethoven's life. So in 1804, Beethoven has started work on his one and only opera. We know it today as Fidelio. At the time he was writing it, it was known as Leonore. Perhaps you've gone to concerts, you know, symphony concerts, and you've seen the Leonore Overture or heard the Leonore Overture 1, 2, or 3. Yes, there are three of them. And then there's actually an overture to Fidelio. So this was a piece that really occupied him and was very important to him to get just right. So to help him get it right, he decided to move closer to the theater. He was put up in some quarters, and those quarters weren't satisfactory. You know, apparently they were so small, his servant had to sleep in the kitchen. And we don't know how much of it is the living circumstances and how much of it is Beethoven's notoriously difficult personality, but he ends up going through about three or four servants, you know, during his time there. And let's remind, you know, that like having a servant was just kind of usual business. You know, it was a very middle class thing to have a servant at this time. So, you know, Beethoven thinks, if I can just get through the summer, you know, the opera will premiere in June and everything will be fine. But the opera didn't premiere in June. The opera actually ended up not premiering until November of the following year. So almost, you know, 18 months later. So during that summer, he moves to the suburbs. And then he ends up eventually taking an apartment in a house that's owned by someone named Baron Johann Baptist von Pasqualati. And the composer would actually go on to reside there on and off for more than a decade. And in fact, these days, that residence is currently a Beethoven Memorial Museum in the Milker Bastei. So the summer of 1984 was significant for me. It wasn't significant for Beethoven. The summer of 1804 is also significant because Beethoven's world was changing. He sees that Napoleon is a tyrant rather than this revolutionary hero that he thought he was going to be. And so he tears off the title page of his Third Symphony in disgust and disappointment, famously says, you know, so he's just a man after all. And it's also around this time, 1804, that Beethoven really does finally come to terms as best as he can with his deafness. He realizes that, you know, it's definitely not going to get better. Whether or not he expected it to worsen is up for debate, but he's at least accepted that, you know, there isn't some miracle panacea for this. This is my condition, and so I just have to figure things out, you know. And famously, you know, Beethoven did all sorts of things to try and amplify his hearing, from, you know, hearing horns to laying his cheek, laying his teeth upon musical instruments. You know, he tries to find other ways to deal with the condition as best as he can. So out of this period of, you know, revolutionary disappointment and, disappointment just in his physical condition, comes really a very, very charming piano sonata, the sonata in F major, opus 54. And it's a work that I think is adored by those who know it. But unfortunately, this is one of those pieces that suffers a little bit from middle child syndrome, because it is smack dab in between the Waldstein sonata and the Appassionata sonata, both of which, you know, are a little more top 40 fare when it comes to classical music. Donald Francis Tovey and Charles Rosen, who, you know, are two of the greatest Beethoven scholars that ever walked the face of the earth, they both extol pianists and listeners alike to really look beyond what appears to be a very simplistic work, you know, and realize that it's actually full of humor. And in the right hands, as it will be for the Grand Piano Series, lots of grace, lots of charm. And it really is an essential work. It's as essential a work to Beethoven's canon and development as any. And one of the things that is noteworthy about this piece in particular is that Beethoven kind of jumps right into the action. You know, Beethoven never really felt fettered by proper sonata writing. And this piece is no different. He jumps right into a minuet, something that we would normally encounter in, say, the third movement, you know, certainly the later movements. It kind of sets us up, you know, for enjoyment and just sort of takes us right into the piece in a very interesting way, a way that was unique for Beethoven's time. So, Milana, can we cue up and play just a little sample of this, the sonata number 22, please? All right, that's probably good enough to give us a little sample. You hear just how, again, you know, what a charming work that this is, that Beethoven has given us. And, you know, it some unusual harmonic progressions in there. And just the density of certain parts of it, too, I think are just going to sound amazing on the Grand Piano Series instrument. So, you know, periodically, if you work in broadcasting, you know, classical music broadcasting in particular, or I think just in musical circles, you sometimes see these lists and postings and surveys. And there was a pretty unscientific study that was done some time ago that claims that the next sonata, the number 23, the Appassionata, is the most frequently performed of Beethoven's piano sonatas, more than Moonlight, more than Opus 110, more than Les Adieux. And, you know, maybe that's true, maybe that's not true. It does seem plausible, if for no other reason than along with the Fifth Symphony, this really is a work that stands as a quintessential example of the composer's heroic style. So this piece was also started in the summer of 1804. But after kind of moving right through the first two movements, the composer suffered a little bit of writer's block when it came to finishing it, you know, writing the third movement. And there's a wonderful account from Ferdinand Ries. Ries was a friend and pupil of Beethoven's, who also served as his secretary for a number of years. And Ries talks about him and Beethoven going on this walk through the woods. And, you know, this wasn't just a little 20-minute constitutional. Apparently, they walked for several hours, and Beethoven would make these grunts, and he would hum a little, and he'd hum some more, and he'd make other odd sounds. In my mind, I'm sort of imagining the cacophony of, you know, sitting, waiting for mass to begin during cold season, and you hear a cough here and a cough there, and sneeze and sniffle there. There was nothing really musical about what Beethoven was doing, except perhaps in his head. So Ferdinand Ries, you know, says to the maestro, you know, what gives? Are you okay? Are you well? And Beethoven says, I think I have an idea. I think I have a theme in my head. I'm just working some things out. So they get back home about 8 p.m., Beethoven doesn't even remove his hat, and he goes straight to the piano keyboard, leaving Ries to just kind of take a chair in the corner and starts to work. Ries refers to it as that Beethoven stormed on in this process for at least an hour. And at some point, I guess Beethoven looks up from his work and, you know, has completely forgotten that Ferdinand is there with him, and then, you know, just sort of looks intently upon him and says, I can't give you a lesson today. I have work to do. So the Appassionata ends up being published a couple of years later in 1807. It's dedicated to Count Franz Brunswick, who is a close personal friend of the composer. Some of you may recall from my earlier lectures, he had sisters, both of whom studied with Beethoven, Teresa, to whom he dedicated the Opus 78, and then Josephine. Now, Beethoven really seemed to be legit in love with Josephine. And as it happened, she resumed studies with him right around the same time. Her husband had passed away. And the proximity and just being around her again kind of rekindled Beethoven's affection for her. By most accounts, she returned his love. She liked him a lot, cared about him deeply. But, you know, Beethoven didn't have the stability. And this was a time where it wasn't okay to marry, quote unquote, beneath your station. So she ends up rejecting his marriage proposal. And, you know, it really did sadden him. She goes on to get married to a count later on, and the marriage really doesn't last. You know, it's a marriage out of convenience, and it only lasts about 3 years. You know, it's since been refuted, but there were many for a long time that thought that Josephine was probably the subject of Beethoven's famous love letter, you know, where he refers to his immortal beloved. Nowadays, we don't think it's her, but for a long time, it seemed the most plausible case, just based on that there really did seem to be a give and take of affection. You know, Beethoven, of course, never did marry. He didn't especially like being alone. And that is one of those things that becomes a theme later on. We'll talk about that some more during the course of this talk. So as mentioned, he dedicates his Opus 78 to, So we should have a little bit of the Appassionata. I thought it would be good for us, you know, since it was the product of this walk through nature, to, you know, to hear, you know, what the woods inspired him to write. So let's hear a little bit of that, Milana. Out of it. I never want to stop in the middle of a piece like that, but we have some other things still to come on this lecture. So what a trip through the woods that must have been, that inspired, you know, Beethoven to write that. That's something that's kind of on one of those little bucket list types of things. I've been able to spend a little time in rural parts of, you know, Germany, less so Austria, you know, but I would love to just figure out what he was walking through, what he was seeing when this is, you know, what comes into his mind. So we continue to the next work. And as mentioned, Beethoven dedicated his Opus 78, the next piano sonata, to Josephine's sister, Teresa. This is the first of, I guess, five sonatas that Beethoven writes between about 1809 and 1816, that are considered by many scholars to be so-called transitional sonatas. So, you know, Beethoven you know, through these works is really beginning to trace his path from the heights of his middle period to what would be his late period of development. About this time, Beethoven gets a really compelling job offer. Napoleon's brother Jerome was appointed king of Westphalia, and he offers for Beethoven to be his Kapellmeister with a very nice regular salary. Times were lean at this time with the wars, and a lot of Beethoven's resources were beginning to dry up, you know, both from, you know, just his own bills that he had to settle up, but just support for some of his works was not as forthcoming as it once had. So, and he was also of a mindset at this time that the musical scene in Vienna maybe wasn't as great as it was when he was a kid. So he was definitely strongly considering taking this job offer, but a group of admirers ended up banding together and offered him something that I don't know that he'd ever had before, by giving him, you know, a guaranteed annuity for life, with the only condition being that he actually stay put in Vienna. And, you know, just that kind of financial security was a game changer for a composer like Beethoven, especially at that time. I mean, it would be a game changer for a lot of composers even today. Even though the value of the dollar amount, this contract was paid in florins, that declined a little bit over the years. It still was something that he could rely on. And that was, again, a big difference maker. So he then, now that he's got financial security, he writes to a friend, and I quote, "Now you can help me look for a wife. She must be beautiful, however, for I cannot love anything that is not beautiful, else I have to love myself," end quote. Ever the charmer, poor Beethoven. As to the sonata, it was offered to Beethoven's publisher around the year 1809. It didn't actually release until the following year. Therese of Brunswick, to whom it's dedicated, actually never married. So maybe Beethoven had affections on the wrong sister. But she went on to devote her life to charitable work, a lot of it centered around young children. So this is a two-movement sonata that was not really written with any sort of particular education aim in mind. It's intimate in its character, and perhaps because it lacks the dramatic tensions of some of Beethoven's other works, it too is somewhat neglected, but like the Opus 54, it definitely has a lot to offer to those who listen. Do we have a little bit of that queued up, Milana? Yeah, perfect. Thank you so much for that. So Beethoven then continues his efforts in the piano sonata world with the sonata number 25, bears the subtitle Alla Tedesca. So remember that that letter I mentioned where Beethoven said he'd like his friend to help him find a wife? That was written to his friend, the Baron Ignaz von Gleichenstein. And it's thought that the Baron introduced Beethoven to this 18-year-old woman named Teresa Malfatti. Beethoven was very smitten with her and wanted to marry her. Apparently, she must have been beautiful. But her family gave a profound and resounding nope. So as it happens, the Baron ended up marrying her sister, but the Baron was a nobleman. The young woman's uncle was a very prominent physician throughout Vienna at that time, and actually treated Beethoven at various points in time, including in his last days. Now, so smitten was he, Beethoven wrote Fiorellis for young Teresa, and many believe that he actually intended to dedicate this sonata to her as well. But there was a lot happening. You know, he may have been unlucky in love, but Beethoven was really having some profound successes with his music away from the piano keyboard around this time. You know, December 22nd, 1808, there's this famous concert where his fifth symphony is performed, as is his sixth symphony, the Pastoral, as is the Choral Fantasy, as is the fourth piano concerto, as are some other choral works. So it was really, you know, that there was an appetite for his music at this time, you know, really says a lot, because I guess the conditions of the theater, this was at the famous Theater an der Wien, you know, the Viennese theater, that, you know, it was incredibly cold and, you know, concert must have gone on for about 3 hours or something like that, maybe more. And people were cold, people were freezing, but they abided it and Beethoven's music. So maybe in the course of all that, he forgot to actually write down a dedication on this piano sonata. This is a work we might describe as a slender piece compared to some of the other piano sonatas. And that is deliberate, along with, you know, a couple of his other short works. This was a piece that was really intended to be accessible to amateur pianists. And really, it was a brilliant business idea on Beethoven's part, because, of course, people wanted to play his music. But there are a lot more amateur pianists out there than concert artists. So he really wanted to adapt something, because I think he was hoping that it would be profitable. And if it worked, he was fine with, you know, at that time, he was fine with creating some works to help keep his coffers full. So he succeeds. In the second and third movement, they are indeed pretty simple in design, you know, simple for Beethoven, you know, simple for Mark Travis, not so much. But it is about as straightforward as perhaps his music gets. But the first movement is pretty darn challenging. So, Milana, let's go ahead and listen to at least some of the first movement, this piece. Thank you. I think we can go ahead and pause there. So again, you know, difficult, not difficult for Beethoven is maybe a different thought process or term than it is for some of the rest of us as mere mortals. It really is another of those works, though, that I'm, you know, happy that audiences are going to have a chance to hear. And really enjoy is part of this exploration of the last of Beethoven's piano sonatas. So we move then to another of Beethoven's most famous sonatas, the Les Adieux, the sonata Opus 81A. Now, we've come to know it as Les Adieux, but Beethoven actually preferred to think of it in the German as Leibwohl. It's a wartime piece. Napoleon bombarded Vienna in May of 1809, and the ensuing occupation of the city led to, you know, extraordinarily difficult circumstances for everybody. Beethoven writes to his publisher, quote, "What a destructive, disorderly life is here around me. Nothing but drums, cannons, and human misery in every form." And, you know, it should be noted that while Beethoven's hearing was failing, it was apparently sensitive in some ways. And so he was, you know, apparently as the area was being shelled with cannon fire, he would be cowering, you know, in a basement or, you know, on the floor as far away from windows as possible with a pillow over his ears to protect himself and protect what remained of his hearing. He goes on to ask his publisher to send him scores by Johann Sebastian Bach, Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach, Haydn, Mozart, for his own personal study at this time. And perhaps to bring him some comfort. Beethoven's isolation during these wartime years also exacerbated what was, you know, serial untidiness where the composer was concerned. I know I've read other depictions of just, you know, how unkempt he could be as a person and in his personal appearance. But there's a written account of his home that reads, find it here, quote, "Picture the dirtiest, most disorderly place imaginable, blotches of moisture covering the ceiling, an oldish grand piano, an unemptied chamber pot, chairs mostly made out of cane covered with plates bearing the remnants of last night's supper, clothing strewn everywhere." So, I mean, really and truly the artist hovel, you know, is what Beethoven is living in. These are his conditions. So this piece emerges, and unlike a lot of Beethoven's works that, you know, have titles, well, this is the only one where he actually has programmatic movement titles. And while a lot of, you know, the subtitles that we identify with his works were posthumous, these were ones that Beethoven came up with on his own and approved of. There was also kind of an insistence on wanting to express things in German as sort of a nationalistic approach. He didn't want to use Italian or Latin and certainly didn't want to use French. Again, perhaps another vote in support of thinking of this piece as Leibwohl, as opposed to Les Adieux. The first movement, which is titled Leibwohl, refers to the departure of Beethoven's friend and patron, the Archduke Rudolf, to escape Vienna and Napoleon's army. And you know, here again, Beethoven was insistent, you know, not only, I guess, from a nationalistic standpoint, but just because he felt that the term Leibwohl was more intimate and something more that a person would say to another person, whereas les adieux, you know, would be a more generic goodbye to a group of people or to an era or to an epoch. And that meant a lot, you know, and you think about this terminology. I mean, Leibwohl is indeed an important part, you know, literally means to live well or live beautifully. And, you know, there's a very moving part of Wagner's Ring Cycle where, you know, Wotan, you know, is put in a position to have to punish his daughter, Brunhilde, but he still, you know, after he lights the magic fire around her, still sings, you know, Leibwohl, you know, live well, live beautifully, my, you know, beloved child. So it really carries with it a lot of weight and was very important to Beethoven. The other two movements were written a little bit later. In English, their titles are The Absence and The Return. But yeah, let's go ahead and hear, you know, there's a motif that occurs throughout this piece. And so let's start at the beginning and just hear a little bit of Les Adieux or Les Vols.
The thing that's different about a Vrbo vacation home, you always have the whole place to yourself.
Let's go ahead and come out of it now. So, I mean, you hear just that resignation and that quiet dignity throughout that first movement, you know, and thinking about that image of Beethoven in this hovel and, you know, the wartime torrents, you know, is really something. This was a work that definitely weighed in on a lot of other major composers as well. Mahler ends up quoting a pretty good part of it, I believe, in the Ninth Symphony, you know, where he really put a lot of his life experiences into that work, you know, quoting from Bach, quoting from Beethoven, and others as well, and kind of signaling his own farewell to the world. So it's very poetic that he would bring in some of Beethoven's Leibwohl or Les Adieux Sonata as a part of that. It bears, I'm not going to go too deeply into this, but, you know, so that opus number, the 81A, was really to distinguish it from some other works that were published about that same time. Beethoven didn't necessarily just settle on a single publisher, as was, you know, it tends to be the case now. Instead, he, you know, would try and publish here and publish there. You know, so he'd have a publisher in London, he'd have a publisher back in Austria, he'd have a publisher in Italy. And sometimes these things all being released at the same time caused a little bit of confusion with the continuity. And so sometimes, you know, we see somewhat strange opus numbers in an attempt to kind of reconcile and eliminate confusion about, oh, yeah, when I say opus 81, I mean this, I don't mean this trio or this quartet or what have you. So in case anyone was curious about that. So his next sonata, number 27, the opus 90, is another short two-movement work. It actually pairs very nicely on a program with the opus 78, but that isn't done very often, at least outside of maybe a college or conservatory environment. The autograph copy of this score is dated from August 16th, 1814, and it was published about a year later. This piece has never been especially popular, but one should note that the musical expressions in it, too, are written in German as a gesture of nationalistic pride. So instead of, you know, saying allegro, you know, he's saying schnell. Instead of saying un poco meno, he's saying ein bisschen mehr, you know, as instructions to the player. Again, feeling very nationalistic about his culture and his language being preserved. The other noteworthy thing when it comes to this piece is that it was the first of Beethoven's works to be published by Steiner. And Steiner actually owned a music shop in Vienna. And if you can imagine this, it was a destination and kind of a hangout spot for Beethoven and several of his friends. You know, I think back to, you know, the local guitar shop, you know, outside Chicago that I knew as a kid. And, you know, what would I have done if somebody like Beethoven had been hanging out around there? It's kind of a nice thought that, you know, and to me, you know, again, humanizes this iconic figure, you know, that why not go? Why go to a coffee house when you can go to the music shop in Vienna and hang out with Beethoven? So, Beethoven then follows this piece 2 years later with a very grand four-movement sonata, number 28, opus 101. And this is a work that very much anticipates the style of Beethoven's last offerings in the genre. But it's one that can be difficult to navigate. You know, parts of it are just strange, you know, for lack of a better word. And in transitions, in terms of his line and in terms of the texture that's employed in certain spots, can seem rather abrupt. It's also an extremely difficult work to perform, and that's a point that Beethoven himself acknowledged. Meanwhile, the political turmoil that surrounded Vienna was starting to subside. Napoleon suffers major defeats at Leipzig, at Waterloo, and the 1814 Congress of Vienna brought about a political settlement to, you know, Napoleon's aggressions. Beethoven's brother, Karl, with a C, Karl Kasper, passes away in 1815, and he names Beethoven as the custodian of his one and only child, Karl, with a K. Karl's mother objects, and so it really gets into a very ugly custody battle. And, you know, this is something that ends up costing Beethoven very dearly, both in terms of his emotional well-being, but also in terms of his finances. He does eventually win the case in 1816. becomes, you know, young Carl becomes his ward. But and it's about that same time, 1816, that the Opus 101, you know, Sonata number 28 emerges. Another interesting thing to note with this work is that it's the first piece where Beethoven specifies that this work is for the Hammerklavier. Now, remember, to study Beethoven in a way is to also study the evolution of piano technology and music technology. You know, one of the first, if not the first, to use, you know, to include metronome markings in his writing. One of the first to stretch the imagination of what the piano could be and could sound like. You know, he was very interested. He couldn't just be contained to a harpsichord. He really conceived on a much bigger scale. And so as such, you know, if you think at the time, you know, there were a lot of used harpsichords and pianofortes and things lying around. And, you know, he did not want his music played on those. He didn't want anybody to think it was okay, you know, to perform his music on these lesser quality instruments. And so he begins to specify, you know, nope, this is for the modern piano, the Hammerklavier. You know, there is also a little bit of thought that this too also fit with kind of this nationalistic crusade, if you will, because, you know, words like pianoforte, you know, weren't just good plain German. So he wanted to really communicate clearly what his ideas were and how his music was supposed to sound. So, bad joke warning, he further hammers this point home. See what I did there? With the Sonata number 29, which is subtitled simply Hammerklavier. This is the piece that we think of as the Hammerklavier Sonata. And I think before I talk about it, it would be useful to hear a little bit of it. So Milana, could you cue that up, please? Let's go ahead and come out of it, only because of time considerations. It really is. You have to understand there was nothing like this that had ever happened before. There was no piece like this in any stretch of the imagination. You know, you may have noticed on there that the duration of the piece is about 40 minutes, and that's probably a good average. You know, I've probably heard performances that go 45. I don't think I've ever heard any that go 35 or less. It is a mighty work and one not to be underestimated in any stretch of the imagination. You know, Beethoven writes to his friend and student Carl Czerny about this piece. I'm writing a sonata now, and this is going to be my greatest, as a direct quote. So, you know, Beethoven definitely had steep, steep ambitions where this work was concerned. And, you know, anyone else making that kind of claim might earn themselves a little side eye, but Beethoven actually delivers the goods. The first movement, of which you got just a little taste, is nothing short of exhilarating. The second movement is at once comic and brusque. The third is like a major tearjerker. And the finale, you know, is one that can invoke both awe as well as terror, you know, maybe awe for the listener and terror for the pianist in the right circumstance. And it's not hyperbole to say that the Hammerklavier is a peerless and astonishingly original work in terms of its duration, in terms of its scope, in terms of its design. I could go on and on. Yet when it came time to publish this piece around 1819 or so, Beethoven was in pretty dire financial straits. Again, largely due to the lengthy custody battle for his nephew. So he enlisted the aid of Ferdinand Ries, you know, the fellow who was walking in the woods with him when he got the idea for the Appassionata, third movement. And so he enlists the aid of Ries to get the work published. And in the letter, he expresses this abnormal, at least for Beethoven, amount of flexibility when it comes to the editing process. He just wanted it published. And that is to a degree at odds with this part of Beethoven, where he really has decided, you know, he's no longer going to write simpler pieces, you know, heck with those amateur pianists, you know, he only wants to write things that aspire to greatness and you know, great spiritual heights, great virtuosic heights. So at any rate, the piece does eventually gets published. And once it's there and a few florin or pounds or what have you are rolling in, Beethoven says, quote, "Now you have a piece that will keep pianists busy even 50 years from now." And boy, he couldn't be more right. I mean, this is one of those works, very frequent lecture recital, graduate student, you know, project or doctoral or performer certificate. I mean, it really is one of those pieces that is just, there's so much about it. And you don't necessarily get to hear it live so very often, and certainly not an instrument like the grand piano series has to offer. So that is really going to be a special treat when Dominic plays the Hammer Clavier Sonata. So, you know, we're close to our time together, but, you know, we have to at least say a few words about the final trio. In a way, I deliberately kept things short, because this too, a lot can be said about the last three sonatas, Opus 109, 110, and 111. A lot has been written about them. And there's a lot that's meaningful, both from the just mechanics of the composition, as well as in the aesthetic, you know, ideas that are expressed. They really do occupy a very special place. You know, these are the summit of Beethoven's work in the genre, you know, and represent his farewell to it, you know. And so there is just such a complexity of spiritual emotion that accompanies them. And you know, these weren't immediately understood at that time. You know, they, you know, Franz Liszt was actually one of the first pianists to undertake these in a concert setting. And it really wasn't until Arthur Schnabel that they started to kind of become the repertoire staples that they are today. Nowadays, you know, it's not all uncommon to hear Opus 109, 110, 111 in succession. I understand all the reasons for doing that. I mean, it's tidy. You know, here are the last three pieces. You know, when we were still buying CDs, the three of them fit on a single CD. Can't remember if they actually all fit on a single LP. I think they may have just barely. But it makes for a very nice set. That said, it can be a little overwhelming to hear these back to back to back, quite honestly. It's almost like adding one extra layer of frosting to a triple layer chocolate cake. It's just, there's so much richness and so much to unpack and so much to experience in these last three works. But that said, I think this is a case where being overwhelmed might actually be a good thing. That it really is a wonderful experience for the senses to hear these works. So these emerge around 1820 to 1822. We kind of lose track of Beethoven for a while. In fact, there's a stretch of time from about September of 1821 to May of 1822, where we have really no documentation that he lived. There's no journals, no letters, no leftover chalkboards, just nothing. So we have to sort of put the pieces together, but we know he was earnestly working on the Missa Solemnis, which he considered to be one of his greatest achievements, if not his greatest achievement and his most important achievement in music. But he clearly had to break up the work on that to honor some other commissions. And so we think these three works emerge from that time, although the Opus 109, we think actually may have been sketched out, at least in part, earlier. So I will say that the Opus 109 is my personal favorite of this set. There is just something about the lilting quality of the opening and the just transcendental nature of the big finale that's really amazing. That said, as a producer, I've probably produced more recordings of Opus 110 than any other piano work, and I understand the appeal, I understand the attraction. But let's, before we wrap things up, let's hear just a little bit of the Opus 109 performed by one of the greatest interpreters alive today, Sir András Schiff. I just very special music. Actually, I'll even share that, that was music I can remember, playing for my son when he was first born, music in the nursery, as a friend of mine had just put a few of those, put the last three sonatas to disc. And that was somehow a little less terrifying than the Opus 110 and all its dramatic fury. But it really is a terrific experience to be able to hear this music. So the last three sonatas are published in 1822. Beethoven is in debt, likely due to all of the illness that he does. I mean, we think it's probably because of illness that we lose track of him at certain points. He dies just 5 years later in 1827. And so it really says a lot that this body of work, these 32 piano sonatas, remain an almost constant companion from the composer's short life from about 1795, you know, the earliest sketches, you know, all the way to 1822, just a few years before we lose him. And so I can think of few other composers or other bodies of work that just so completely and totally accompany the artist throughout their development and their lifetime. So, you know, the chance to experience all of these over the course of the last few years has just been an incredible journey. It's an incredible journey that you're about to complete. And so I will just say thank you to Milana and Raniero and Greg and all of the board and the audience members, you know, that have invited me to be a part of this journey with you. It's been just as meaningful for me as I hope that it has been for all of you.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you so much. And to hear the very last sonata, Opus 110, you'll just have to 111, sorry. You'll have to come and attend the concert and hear it.
Absolutely.
But Mark, thank you for this lecture. Thanks for preparing us to kind of embark on this journey. It's going to be a four-day festival that we are going to embark on. The first day is the three highlights from the past recitals, where you will hear the Moonlight, the Pathetic, and the Waldstein. But then we will continue this journey with Paul Williamson will take us on the last stretch, and Dominic will join, and Rodolfo will finish up this whole recital series. And right now, Mark, you're in New York, we are in Southwest Florida, and you are probably aware that we had a really terrible hurricane. But it's a challenging time right now for many, for I would say for everybody, even if they were not directly affected. I think there's this general heaviness in the air that we feel. And Grand Piano Series is offering complimentary tickets to the whole community. And I really hope people will take time just to unplug from the heavy feelings, the stress, and whatever they're dealing with, and just come and quietly sit and listen to this incredible body of work, music. Even if you can come only to one recital, please come and encourage everybody to join us. And those of you who already have your tickets, spread the word, bring your friends and join us. We really would love to see you all. And on this note, I want to thank all of you who tuned in. I know many more will be tuning in later on when it's going to be posted on YouTube. And Mark, thank you. Thank you for joining us.
My pleasure. Thanks again for having me.
All right. Take care, everybody.